I respect senior professors and other colleagues, organizing secretary, Dr. Kanagavel, all the beloved PGs, everybody is welcoming in behalf of Chennai City branch. We are starting clinical presentations. It will be useful for you. So everyone, you ask your colleagues, everyone should come and attend. Thank you very much.
A brief model of arrangement, what has been done. There have been few cases which are designated as short cases and long cases. So they will be present. Short case will be for 15 minutes. The examiners have unanimously agreed that you will not be stopped during your presentation. But then once you have completed your presentation, you may not be able to give more inputs. So short cases, you need not go by entire thing, relevant positive and negative history, and go to the positive clinical findings alone. You don't need a full presentation. So it will be for 15 minutes. Long case will be for 30 minutes. Finish off the presentation by 5 to 7 minutes. Again, the examiners will not interrupt till you finish to come to the diagnosis. So make sure you will not be able to revisit, sir, I missed this or missed that. So concentrate, you will not be disturbed till you come to the diagnosis. With that in mind, may I now call upon the first batch of students, Dr. Ratnam and Dr. Ankush from Sri Balaji Medical College Hospital, under the professorship of Professor K.S. Ravi Shankar, to present the first case. Can you come up on the stage? And for that, it is indeed a proud privilege for me. I think everybody is my teacher. When I did my post-graduation, it's my honor to call upon the teacher of teachers, Professor T. Gunasagaran sir, to come up to the stage to lead the academic delegation. Professor K.S. Ravi Shankar sir, Professor Kuberan sir, Professor Kaliappa sir, and Dr. Sudipta Swain.
Good morning to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank the ASA team to making me sit along with my teachers here. The first case is from inguinal hernia from Sri Balaji Medical College. Or in the examination, you present. Don't look at the laptop. You present to the audience straight away.
A patient of 43 years old male from Guindy who is a labor worker, daily labor worker, who came with the complaints of swelling over the inguinal region for past 6 years. Swelling, history of presenting illness, the swelling in the right inguinal region for 6 years, which was insidious in onset and gradually progressing to the current state. And there is patient aggravates there is no aggravating factors and there is no relieving factors, but no history of pain, no history of constipation, no history of vomiting, there is no history of urinary symptoms, there is no history of cough, history of heavy weight lifting present, past history, there is no history of similar complaints in the past. Not a known case of any pulmonary TB or diabetic hypertension. No past surgical interventions also. Personal history is occasional alcoholic, non-smoker. He has a normal bowel and bladder habits. There's no family, a similar family history. Examination will be sent by...
On examination, patient is conscious, oriented, well-built and nourished. No pallor, no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing or lymphadenomatosis present or any pedial edema is there. BP is 130-80, pulse rate was recorded as 88 and it was normal in rhythm, normal in volume and character. On inspection of the right side of the scrotum, patient is first examined in standing position and later in the supine position. A large swelling of size 10x8 cm is present in right inguinal region. It's spherical in shape, a smooth surface, which extends 5 cm medial to right anterior superior iliac spine to the root of scrotum. Its skin over the swelling is normal. It's not reducing and visible cuff impulse is not present. The penis is deviated to the left side because of the large right side. There is no scar sinuses or the dilated veins over the skin over the scrotum. On palpation, there is no warmth, no tenderness. All inspectory findings are confirmed. Swellings is not fully reducible. It's doughy in consistency. Cuff impulse is not present. testes and cord structures are normally palpable, and it is not possible to get above the swelling. On a specific test, deep ring occlusion test and Zeeman three fingers test, we were not able to assess as the testes, as the swelling was not reducing, so it was not able to get. On percussion, dull note is felt. Auscultation, there is no peristalsis heard. Then examination of contralateral side comes to be normal. Examination of testes, epididymis, and spermatic cord structures are normal. Tone of abdominal muscle normal. No malgasny bulge. Bulge is present. No evidence of phimosis. A structure of urethra or any pale hole meatus of urethra. Per-rectum examination normal. No prostatomegaly, no fissure. Per-abdomen examination, abdomen is normal. Umbilicus in midline. No evidence of any hernia, any scar marks. No abdomen is soft, no organomegaly, no mass palpable. Bowel sounds are present on auscultation. Other system, respiratory system, bilateral vascular sounds are present. Heard both sides, no added sounds are present. Cardiovascular system, normal S1 and S2 heard, no murmurs present. Diagnosis, right irreducible, complete inguinal hernia with omentum as content. Investigations. For investigation, we'll go for routine blood investigations like CBC, RFT, serum electrolytes, chest X-ray, PA view, ultrasound abdomen to measure the defect size. Treatment, we'll go for bilateral Lichenstein tension-free mesh repair.
I think the diagnosis is going to be fairly simple in this. You should tell me, why you say it's a hernia? What are the points on which you say it's a hernia?
It's actually swelling arising from inguinal scrotal lesion, and it's a reducible swelling. It has cuff impulse, and getting above the swelling is not possible. So that which favors the point of being an inguinal hernia. Sir.
You said irreducible or reducible swelling?
Irreducible, sir.
Irreducible swelling. Yes, sir. Did you do any test to confirm? How do you know that then it's a direct or indirect hernia then?
Sir,
you said you didn't do any test.
Yes, sir. Sir, actually, sir, the sac, sir, it was partially reducible only, sir. Sir, actually, it was not.
See, when you are not able to do all three tests, how yes, can you say that it is reducible or irreducible?
Sir, we are not able to, we cannot actually say, sir, that it's direct or indirect, sir. It's not, we cannot assess because we have not done the test.
So is there any other point to say it's a direct hernia or indirect hernia?
So it's the swelling is very large, sir. So large swelling is in favor of indirect hernia, sir, mainly. And it's complete hernia coming to the base of the scrotum. So most probably it is indirect hernia, sir.
Usually direct hernia will confine to the triangle, whereas in the indirect hernia will descend into the scrotum. Mm-hmm. That's one way you can differentiate if you are not able to do all other three tests. Is there any other differential diagnosis you can offer?
Femoral hernia, saphenovarix, sir, inguinal lymph nodes, lymphadenopathy, inguinal lymphadenopathy, any testicular
that,
tumor.
That is not a site for a lymph node, is it?
Sir, hydrocele, because big testis is there, sir.
No. What type of hydrocele you can think of there?
Vaginal hydrocele.
Vaginal hydrocele. No, any other hydrocele you know?
Encysted hydrocele of
suppose
cord.
If it's a vaginal hydrocele, suppose if it extends up to the level of inguinal region, what type of hydrocele it is? Classically, when the patient lies down, it disappears and appears on standing.
Infantile hydrocele.
Infantile hydrocele, okay. Normally, the vaginal hydrocele will not extend into the inguinal deep region. It's confined only to the root of the scrotum. It will not extend beyond that. Yes, the only differential. Any other point? Encysted hydrocele of the cord. Can you think of?
It's not reducible, sir.
That also will not be reduced. Encysted hydrocele of the cord.
So traction test will do, sir, to rule out the encysted hydrocele of cord, sir.
Okay. Any other test? One is traction test. Any other test?
Sir, because bilateral testes are palpable, sir. Cord structures
no,
are...
No. in encysted hydrocele. One is traction test. What about transelimination?
Transelimination will be positive in hydroceles.
Will not be there in hernia. But you didn't do transelimination for this case, is it?
No,
which
sir,
you could have mentioned. You are supposed to do that. Having irreducible swelling confined up to the level of root of the scrotum, you could have done that.
You told about saphenovarix. Saphenovarix is never a differential diagnosis for inguinal hernia. It is a differential diagnosis for femoral hernia. So if the swelling is below the inguinal ligament only, you should think of that. Here already the swelling has come into the scrotum. There is no, you should not think about saphenovarix. Sometimes there is another condition called lipoma of the cord. Some large lipoma of the cord may present like a hernia. It may not be able to reduce it. These are some of the different conditions which can occur like that. Again, a large hernia, sliding hernia, will not be able to reduce.
Okay, so one of your DD was femoral hernia. So just coming to the basics, how do you differentiate femoral hernia from inguinal clinically?
So by three fingers Zeeman test, we can differentiate, sir.
Yeah, other than on inspection or palpation at the beginning.
Hernia will come from femoral opening, sir, which will be 4 cm below and lateral to pubic tubercle. It will be retort shape.
What is the relation to the pubic tubercle, femoral and...
4 cm below and lateral to pubic tubercle, sir.
No, it is very simple. It is medial and above. It is lateral and below.
Yes, sir.
Okay, that should be the answer.
To start with, the complaint, patient's own words, do not start with the inguinal swelling. Okay, complaint to start with. The groin swelling. Okay. Then, on general exam, do not start with the conscious oriented all these things. You always keep a conscious patient to you. This is unnecessary. Okay. And what are the precipitating factors for the this case?
He's a daily laborer patient. The patient is a daily laborer by occupation, so history of weightlifting is positive, sir.
Okay.
So that can be a precipitating factor in this case.
Okay. And you told irreducible. Huh?
Yes,
then
sir.
Why is told hernia? Is any cough impulse is there or not?
Sir, not present, sir. Cough impulse.
Then how
you
can say hernia? Some amount of cough impulse must be there,
sir,
to say hernia.
So on palpation alone, sir.
Do you think it's a complicated hernia, strangulated or obstructed?
No, sir. No feature of the strangulation or obstruction is there.
Then cough impulse must be there. Without doubt, you can say hernia.
So only on palpation, sir, mild cough impulse is present, sir, after we partially reduce the swelling.
Is there or not? Cough impulse.
Mild is there, sir, on palpation. Only on palpation, sir, it's there. Visible cough impulse is not present, sir.
Expansile impulse on cough. Not, don't say cough impulse.
Expansile
impulse on cough. And ultrasound, you told. Why ultrasound for hernia? Why are you doing ultrasound for this patient?
So first is to see the defect size. Then
defect size immaterial, yeah. Why you want this defect size?
So prostate, we'll see the prostate.
That is important. Any abdominal, any other mass in the abdomen, or free fluid in the abdomen, that will increase intra-abdominal pressure. And prostate size, posterior residual urine. Not to assess the defect size, and to know the content. Whatever, maybe you are going to operate. Okay. That is important, okay. Then which is the ideal investigation to assess the urine outflow obstruction? Not only ultrasound, any other additional...
Uroflowmetry we
Uroflowmetry
can do, sir,
to assess urinary outflow obstruction is there or not. Staining for micturition or not.
Yes,
okay, eh? And truss is more specific to assess the prostate size.
Yes, sir.
Okay, rather than this simple ultrasound abdomen. Okay.
Yeah, when you talk about ultrasound or any investigation for hernia, nowadays it's become increasingly necessary to have documentary evidence. Because most of the cases you are operating under insurance. The insurance company definitely asks you for a...
ultrasound.
They are not accepting your clinical diagnosis. You have to have a investigation, at least in the form of ultrasound. And for probably a ventral hernias, not apart from inguinal hernias, ventral hernias, you may even have to do a MRI so that it will spot the weakness, area of weakness and other things. This may not be useful for a clinical person, may not like this, but we have to live with the tide. So you'll have to may have to do at least a minimal of ultrasonogram for diagnosing a hernia, and as sir said, for enlargement of prostate also it may be useful with the amount of residual urine.
See, one more point. In irreducible hernia, you can say on palpation expansive cough impulse is it, sometimes you can feel the gurgling sound, suppose if the contents are intestine. In case of omentum, it's very difficult.
Yes,
for you, it's an irreducible hernia.
Yes,
maybe that reason you're not able to locate on inspection.
Yes.
On palpation, definitely you could have made it, being irreducible. Because it's not obstructed hernia that is completely expansive cough impulse is absent. Irreducible hernia, you can feel whether it's omentum or contents, intestinal contents. Going for investigation, what's the specific investigation? What's the cause for your patient?
Sir, weightlifting, sir, he's a daily laborer by occupation. So weightlifting history is there, sir.
The weightlifting is the cause for this patient. Everybody is lifting weight, you see, you could have seen in the road. Nobody's getting hernia, is it?
Sir, because it's not
weightlifting, it's an interesting aspect of hernia, which majority of the students think, and no book gives that weightlifting causes hernia. No book gives weightlifting causes hernia. See, if weightlifting is causing a hernia, all the heavyweight lifters in the Olympics and other things should be having surgery for hernia. Nothing like that happens. So it is now said weightlifting is not an exaggerated cause. It's a basic defect in the collagen. That should be the cause for hernia. And people have lift weights that are aggravated to it. So you have known other causes like chronic smokers in which collagen becomes weak, other collagen diseases, associated collagen diseases. These bound to be the cause for hernia. And nowadays, we are less often we see. Previously, we used to read that fat is a pile driver and you get a hernia, all fatty persons, obese patients. Even that, I think it is not true. If you have an indirect hernia, most often it's a preformed sac, which a hernia manifests much later. You have a congenital hernial sac, but you don't manifest it as a child. As a child, man grows, it may manifest. But whereas a direct hernia, that may be causes may be different. The obstruction to the outflow of urine, constipation, and COPDs, all these things could be caused for a direct hernia. I think Professor Gunasagan has got some points to say on this.
No, this is an examination. It's a mock examination, so we'll only ask questions. Now, was it reducible? Was there a history of this swelling being reducible earlier? Did you ask that question?
Yes, sir. So initially state...
You never mentioned it in your history. You never mentioned it. Which is a very important fact to say that it was reducible and now it is irreducible. That's a very, very important point, clinical point in terms. You did not say that in your history. Secondly, was there a scrotal swelling which was not reducible? Did you say that in your history? Because I suppose you realize why I'm asking this question. Was there an irreducible swelling in the scrotum which was associated with the reducible component, which again will make it relevant to come to a conclusion? That's the second question. Third, coming to the examination, you on inspection, you said that there is an inguinoscrotal swelling. At that point, you never said about the cough impulse. Only on palpation, you said about the cough impulse, which I thought was not in... You should have said there's no cough impulse on inspection.
Yes, sir. I mentioned.
Because an expansile cough impulse is better seen than felt.
Felt, yes.
So that's an important point which you did not mention. I'm not on a fault-finding mission, but this is an examination. Then coming to the examination itself... Did you examine the other side testis?
Yes, sir. Contralateral. I mentioned,
right,
sir. Normal.
Now, what? Why is it important that you should examine the opposite side?
Sir, to... Because contralateral also, sir...
It could be a bilateral hernia.
Bilateral hernia.
Yes. And that could be irreducible. So, that is a very important fact to say that there is no inguinal hernia on the other side.
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, coming to the examination itself, you said there is no cough impulse. You said you're not able to get above the swelling.
Yes, sir.
But you said it is complete. That was your diagnosis because it reached the bottom of the scrotum.
Yes, sir.
Only when it is reducible and it reaches to the bottom of the scrotum, you will say it is complete. When you're not having a reducible component, you do not say it.
Okay,
and finally, we have not gone into treatment, but before that, when you present a case, it should be a single individual who should present the case entirely, not in a dual form. You don't appear for the examination as two individuals. So this is another point that in the next time, a single individual must examine and present the case as in the examination. And have you got a written form you're reading out of the, you're reading out of your of our laptop? In the examination, what I would do first is to take away the paper, which I'm sure all of them will do, and you will be asked to present. So you will not have a paper to read out from. And this is not only in this country, wherever you go. After all, you must be prepared to go and pass international, national and international examinations. So you ought to be like that. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
So you need to be very precise. And you gave a whole list of negative findings, which is not important. The negative findings you would have already written in the case sheet. So you must, and the examiners know about it. So don't waste time of the examiner. The time is very precious. We're going to treat.
Treatment.
So in this case, we'll go for right side Liechtenstein.
Use the mic. I'm close to the mic.
So in this case, sir, we'll go for Liechtenstein, tension-free, open hernia surgery repair, sir.
Now, your diagnosis has not been confirmed. So you have straightaway gone to the treatment of the hernia. So how would you treat this patient? How would you treat this patient?
First, we'll confirm the diagnosis by investigations.
Investigations. You can confirm the investigations by this diagnosis by investigations thoroughly.
Imaging through.
Where exactly would you make the diagnosis in this case? Because it's an irreducible swelling in the inguinal scrotal region. How would you confirm the diagnosis? You can only suppose that it is something. How would you clinch the diagnosis? I'll put it even better on the table. How would you confirm it?
Sir, after anesthesia, sir, muscles will reduce, sir, intraoperatively, sir, after giving anesthesia, the muscles will relax.
So, now we go on to the next stage. What would be the incision for this patient?
Inguinal scrotal incision we'll give, sir.
Right. Now, that in other words, if it's an inguinal hernia, what would the incision be?
Inguinal crease.
Yeah. Now you see, you yourself have said that's an inguinal scrotal incision.
Yes, sir.
Why do you want to do an inguinal scrotal incision? What is the reason you want to do it?
Because it's not reducing, sir.
All right. You made the incision on the skin. Then what would be your next step?
So we'll deep scarpa's layer and campus layer will open, sir.
What is the next layer that you would incise?
External oblique upon your.
External oblique. Then.
And so we'll open up, we'll see the cord structure, cremaster.
Cord structure?
Cremaster will be there.
In this irreducible hernia, what would be the most vital step?
Sac will be present, sir, after opening external oblique.
You must say that. See, this is an examination. This is not a teaching session. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. All right. You open the sac. What do you expect to find?
We'll find the contents. We'll see, sir, either omentum or bowel.
What do you expect to find, sir? So you must give a single choice.
According to my examination, sir, since consistency is doughy, sir, we expect to find omentum inside the content.
Omentum. All right. Now you got omentum. Now what will you do next?
So we'll try to reduce the omentum.
Reduce it. Is this the way you would treat an irreducible hernia which got an omento seal?
Sir,
now you understand. In other words, you ought to be prepared mentally. The case has been given to you. You need to know how you're going to treat it. Because you cannot come to a clinical diagnosis fully. You can only give a differential diagnosis. But of course, you're given a most probable diagnosis you have given. All right. Now that you have delivered the omentum into the wound, what would you do?
So we'll see any adhesions are there, sir.
Then?
If not possible to reduce, sir, we'll go
for... Reduce it. You push the whole thing into the abdomen.
So we'll see for the viability. We'll see.
What is the danger of pushing it into the abdomen?
Sir, whole volume will go...
Anyway, I think I have taken a lot of time. I'll give it to the other examiners.
See, actually, you have to pull out the momentum. You have to look for the viability. You cannot push everything inside, is it? The patient will go for a distension and all. If it's a gut, you can reduce it completely. Yes.
Sir, if gut, sir, then we'll see for the viability of the...
Yes, yes. If it is viable, you have to push it entire thing inside, not momentum.
Do you expect that this content to be not viable?
Sir, it'll be viable only then, sir, because no sign of...
Then why do you expect it to be viable?
Sir, because there's no sign of strangulation. Sir, no sign of strangulation is there,
what
sir.
What sign?
No pain.
Is the yes. So there's no symptoms. Then you also will see.
Okay, after that, you deliver the momentum. After that?
So after delivering, we'll see for the viability.
Okay.
If adhesions are there, we'll remove. If not possible to reduce, then we'll do momentectomy.
If it's viable, what will you do then?
Sir, if possible, we'll reduce it. If otherwise, go for momentectomy, sir, if excess.
How will you decide whether the momentum has to be excised or not?
Yes, sir, we need to excise, sir, because...
How will you decide?
Sir, if it's not huge, sir, because a lot of momentum is outside, sir. If it's not, if we're not able to reduce, then we might go for omentectomy.
So, sorry, I am coming back. So, in an ultrasound, why you do the points, sir, for the actually the audience and the students? The ultrasound not only says the content, it says whether it's a sliding hernia or not. It makes a difference when you manage, when you put the incision, when you go for the surgery, to know whether it's a sliding content is there or not, one. Second thing, also to look at the other side, whether there is a subclinical hernia or a persistent processus vaginalis on the other side. And also to look into the intra-abdominal condition, whether anything else is there which is aggravating or is associated with that. So these are the points you have to tell when you're doing ultrasound. If you have told ultrasound, I am going to do. Regarding momentum, yes, if it is easily going in, there is nothing to wrong saying that I will reduce it. But if it is difficult, bulky, adherent to the sac, then you have to excise. And we don't expect non-viability in this condition as per the history.
All right, then after you have excised the momentum, even if it's viable or not, you'll excise it. And then what will be the next step in your treatment?
Will then remain?
Normally, if it's because it's a postgraduate examination, if it's an undergraduate examination, our questions will be different. Okay. That's why I'm going into this detail, because you're going to treat this patient.
After omentectomy, sir, the leftover momentum will try to reduce?
Yeah, you have ligated the momentum, excised the excess and pushed it back.
Yes,
and then what will you do?
Then we'll hold the sac and ligate.
What will you do with the sac?
Transfix.
How
the sac
you? How? What will you do with the sac?
We'll transfix and ligate.
No. Before you have to dissect out the sac, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
What are the steps that you will take when you dissect the sac out?
So if any adhesions are there to the sac, we'll.
No, when you dissect out the sac, there are certain precautions that you need to take. There are certain structures that you need to identify and save or conserve. Because the sac will not come off in your hand. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
This is a postgraduate exam. This is not an undergraduate exam where you will not expect an undergraduate to say. In a postgraduate exam, you ought to know, because you're going to be treating this patient.
What are the structures you will separate from the sac?
Sir, content of the sac will
irreducible hernia. You've already opened the sac and gone inside and dealt with the momentum. Yes, now, sir. The sac has to be separated from the surrounding structures.
Yes, what sir, are the important structures? The cord structure will separate it from the cord structure, sir.
Huh?
We'll separate from the cord structure, sir.
What are the contents of cord structures?
Sir,
you have to isolate from the cord structures, yes, is it? How precaution you take? What are the structures you preserve?
Sir, we'll vast difference will be there, sir. Three arteries will be there, testicular artery, cremaster artery, and artery to vas difference. Three nerves will be there. Sympathetic.
Have you at any time witnessed or done an obstructed hernia as an emergency? Have you done it?
Yes, sir.
You've done. Then what did you do when you wanted the sac to be dissected out?
So the ring we will, remove the. So first we'll open the fundus.
The cord will be in the form of a cord, or in what way will it the cord present it to the surgeon? How will the cord look like? Will it look like a cord, or how will it look like to you? Now, if you're assisted or seen an obstructed hernia, you should know it. Now you understand this is not a teaching session. This is an examination. This is exactly what we are trying to impress on you. Now, this is exactly how you will be asked questions in the examination. Normally, we would not keep an inguinal hernia. But this seems to be a little challenging case in terms of coming to a conclusion and then treating. That's why we are asking you these questions.
We will, any adhesions to the cord, we will separate, sir. Adhesions of the cord to the surrounding structure, we will release the adhesions.
All right, what are the structures you will be very careful to preserve?
So, nerves will be there, sir. Nerve
what?
Ilioinguinal nerve and ilio-hypogastric nerves, sir.
See, what are the structures there in the cord?
So, test vas difference will be there, sir.
So, what are the structures you preserve?
So, all the cord structures are including.
What are the cord structures, man?
Testicular artery, artery to cremaster, artery to.
What's the important structure is there before you going for a testicular artery?
Vas difference, sir.
Yes, you say that vas difference then.
Pampiniform plexus will be there, sir. Lymph nodes will be there, sir. And nerves will be there, sir. Genito branch, genitofemoral nerve will be there, sir. Sympathetic nerve will be there, sir. Sympathetic nerves.
Sympathetic. You are not able to see all these things. You can see only vas, sometimes testicular artery and pampiniform plexus. You cannot see all these things. Will you isolate the nerve there?
No, sir.
You should not isolate. It's outside the sac. You cannot isolate the nerve. You should not do it also. What's the next step?
Sir, I will... we'll close the sac, sir, transfix and ligate the sac,
where
reduce.
At what level you close the sac?
So at the base of the base. Sac.
No, there is no base. At what level you close the sac?
What are the various parts of
the structures of sac,
neck,
parts of the sac, you tell me?
Mouth, body, neck and fundus. Mouth, neck, body and fundus.
Where is mouth, man?
The opening of the...
I don't know whether the modern...
No. It's only if... There is no mouth. Is it opened? Mouth is opening, opening structure. Is it opened? Sac is not opened, is it?
So neck, body and fundus.
Fundus, body and?
Neck.
Neck. So where will you ligate?
At the neck, sir.
At the level of?
Neck. Deep ring.
How will you identify the neck?
It will be near the deep ring, sir.
Near the deep ring. How will you identify the deep ring?
So it will be the defect in fascia transversalis, sir.
How will you identify the deep ring?
The cord will be coming from there.
Cord will be where? How will you know that it is at the level of the deep ring that you are going to transfix the sac?
The preperitoneal fat will be there, sir. Preperitoneal fat will be there.
Preperitoneal fat you will see. Okay, then.
Which vessel come there? Which vessel come?
Inferior epigastric artery, sir.
What will be the relationship of the inferior epigastric artery to the sac?
So it will be lateral to the inferior.
Lateral.
Sir, deep ring will be lateral. Deep ring will be lateral to the inferior epigastric artery.
In relation to sac, always you should say, not about the ring. Don't worry about the ring. About the sac, it's what like an indirect hernia?
So indirect hernia, it will be lateral, sir.
To?
Inferior epigastric artery.
That's all.
And direct will be medial.
When we can't access the sac, when you are not supposed to remove the sac.
Sir, if sliding hernia is there, sir, we should not open the sac, sir.
Why?
So because it will contain, sir, vital structures like urinary bladder, cecum, or sigmoid colon can be there, so it might get damaged, sir.
Part of the sac formed by a viscera.
Viscera.
You can't, you can't access. Okay, you may damage the viscera.
So you're having so much confusion with the relation of inferior epigastric artery. That's why currently the hernias are classified as lateral and medial and not indirect and direct. Yes, the current class of European hernias, European classification European says, it's a lateral hernias are indirect, medial hernias are direct.
So isolate the sac, everything done. What else you do? You want to open procedure, what else you do?
Laparoscopic, we can go. Open procedure,
In open procedure, what will you do?
Herniorrhaphy will do, sir, with Lichenstein mesh.
Here you want to do herniorrhaphy or hernioplasty?
Hernioplasty, sir.
Hernioplasty.
Lichenstein.
So Lichenstein hernioplasty. What are the precautions? What are the important key points when you select the mesh and how you are going to fix? Short of time, make it
synthetic,
fast.
Synthetic mesh will proline.
Synthetic polypropylene.
Polypropylene mesh.
Yes, okay. Large pore or a short? Small pore.
Small pore.
No, it's only large pore. Next. So what are the precautions you take while fixing the mesh? What's the size of the mesh?
15 cross 15 mesh or 7.5 into 15.
Not 15 by 15, it's 7 by 7 into 15.
7.5 into 15.
Next.
And sir, we'll take care of the vessels.
How will you place it? You want to strengthen the posterior wall, is it?
Medially we'll fix to the pubic tubercle. Periosteum of pubic tubercle, superior to the conjoint tendon, sir, inferior to the inguinal ligament. And
you'll cover the internal ring? How you are going to fix it?
So first, inferior medial part will connect to the pubic tubercle. And the superiorly, we'll suture it to the conjoint tendon. Inferiorly, we'll...
See, your aim is to cover the entire myopectineal orifice.
Yes, sir.
So you have to select the mesh 7 into 15 size. Only thing is the important key points here is you have to cross the pubic tubercle of 2 cm and rectus about 3 to 4 cm. Beyond the internal ring about 5 to 6 cm. And the second point is you have to isolate the nerve. Never isolate the nerve from the fascia, cremastic fascia or transversalis fascia. So always avoid, don't isolate the nerve because the chance of inguinodynia is very common after that. Avoid it when you take a bite also. And fix along the conjoint tendon as well as the inguinal ligament and lay open and beyond the cord structure also. These are the very important key points, very important for that also.
One more question. So why you need to overlap the mesh, like the borders like sir described?
So to prevent medial recurrence, sir, because chance of medial recurrence is very common.
So every mesh contracts by 30% in long run, one. Even in the inguinal ligament when you are putting fixing, it should overlap.
Sir, voice is not audible, sir.
That is one of the point. And regarding the internal ring, so either you have to make a fistel and close it, crossover, or you have to put a plug.
So we'll do lytle repair, we'll do narrowing.
Okay. What is the intention of putting the mesh?
To reinforce the posterior wall tension.
So to give the give strength?
So to reinforce, to make it tension free and reinforce the posterior wall, sir.
So the answer should be like it forms a framework over the tissue, regrows and gives strength.
Yes, sir.
Mesh doesn't give the strength. Suppose this is not a reducible, a straightforward case, reducible hernia. So we have other approach also, laparoscopy.
Yes,
so laparoscopy, hernia, what are the, how will you approach and?
Two types of laparoscopic surgeries are advised.
Yeah.
One is TAP and TEP. TAP is transabdominal peritoneal.
One is transabdominal peritoneal.
Transabdominal, sir, will go like we do for a normal laparoscopic procedure.
So the other one is, the last one recently, which is E-TAP. What is E-TAP?
E-TAP is a total extra peritoneal repair TAP.
What is E?
E is extra.
So it is extended or enhanced
extended,
view?
Extended.
Okay. So that also applies to ventral hernias.
Yes, sir.
So when you are describing laparoscopy, they will ask 2-3 questions, like the anatomy in laparoscopy is totally different than what we are discussing here. Yes, so if you are discussing, there are two triangles they normally ask.
Triangle of,
so one is triangle of doom and another
triangle of pain.
Pain. In triangle of pain is mainly because of the knobs. What are the knobs you encounter?
Genitofemoral nerve and femoral.
Not genitofemoral.
Branch, genital branch of genitofemoral.
No, it is femoral branch of genitofemoral.
Femoral branch of genitofemoral nerve. And lateral cutaneous nerve of
Then femoral, thigh. Lateral cutaneous.
Nerve of thigh.
So these are the knobs you encounter. And what is the importance of that? Why you discuss that? What are the borders?
So borders are medially will be testicular vessels.
Yes.
And sir, laterally will be peritoneal
reflection.
Peritoneal reflection and iliopectin tract.
Okay. So the, what is the importance of it? Surgically.
So nerves are there, so nerve entrapment would be.
So you should not put tackers on that when you are fixing the mace one. So the triangle of doom, what we call, is mainly because of the vessels. And it contains all the knob, that is femoral branch of genitofemoral. Thank you.
Now, anyway, one small suggestion to the organizers. Just as we have in these reality shows, I think the audience must vote without identity as to whether the candidate has passed or failed. This need not be advertised to everybody, but it should be, the result should be given to the candidate, so this becomes a very good way of assessing. Thank you.
The most difficult case for a postgraduate examination is inguinal hernia. Yes, sir. Sir, please, sir. Sir, one second. Sir, when they keep an inguinal hernia, the examiner knows much better than the candidate. So, you should always have a doubtful result whether we clear the exam or not. So, don't take inguinal hernia. It's simple. Prepare well. It's commonly kept in the PG exams nowadays.
Thank you, sirs, for your valuable comments and inputs. Thank you, postgraduates. I now request Professor Dr. R. Kannan, Director, Institute of General Surgery, Madras Medical College, Professor Dr. Uttra Kumar, and Professor Dr. Vivekananda to present our panelists with certificates of honor.
Thank you. One important thing I wanted to tell you is that three generations of professors are there. Professor Gunasagaran is here, I was his assistant, and Professor Kannan was my assistant. And I think MMC does a lot well under the